立法會主席.
The President. This council will continue to discuss the motion moved by Mr. Wong Yuk-man under the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance. We'll continue with our debate. Mr. Wong Kok-hing, President. Before I speak on the subject, I would like to discuss about this fourth alarm fire, which is in its fourth day, which is being still going on. Two courageous senior firemen for putting out the fire and saving people died on duty. They've left behind their wives and children. It is really heartbreaking. I feel so sad. I would like to take this opportunity to show my greatest regrets and pay my tribute to these two courageous firemen who died on duty. I would like to express my condolences towards them. And before this meeting, I would like to, towards the Secretary for Security and the Undersecretary for Security, express my, on behalf of FTU, our deepest regards and condolences, and through the Secretary and the Undersecretary, I would like to express our deepest condolences to the family members of the two firemen. For those firemen who are still putting up a brave fight on site, I would like the two secretaries to convey my regards to them, and I hope that they could keep up their good work. And Secretary and Undersecretary, the firemen are under your leadership. This is a very rare fourth alarm fire, which is still yet to be put out. There are no residents in that building. When you develop different approaches to put out the fire, you must accord top priority to the personal safety of the frontline firefighters. You should adopt that principle in devising your firefighting approaches. And I hope that the Secretary and the Undersecretary and the senior management of the FSD should consider my suggestion. While I hope that the frontline firefighters can put up a brave fight against a fire, they should also have due regard to their personal safety in considering what approaches to adopt to put out the fire. Once again, on behalf of the FTU, Federation of Trade Unions, and also the legislators from the FTU, would like to pay my condolences to the two firemen who died on duty. President, I would now like to speak on the matter of the debate. I speak against Mr. Raymond Wong's motion moved under the PNP ordinance to set up a select committee to inquire into the Mong Kok riot, which happens on the second day of the Chinese New Year. The mover of the motion and the supporters Well, their motion, there is nothing as the most ridiculous, but there are always things which are more ridiculous. Why did I make that criticism? The mover of the motion and also the supporters of the motion, this group of opposition legislators, in the past few years, both within and outside the council, were inciting and participating in violence and disrupted the order of the council and disrupted the order of Hong Kong. We will not forget the legislators who move the motion and the supporters of the motion were the same people who held a glass bottle, grabbed the mic, hurled ink at people, and they were involved in physical scuffles, and they were trying to attack or besiege the chairman of meetings, and they were causing disruption to meetings. This is the same group of people. During the 79 day of illegal occupied movement, they were surrounding the LegCo complex and they used it as a headquarters command post for this movement. They were inciting the riots and disturbances and they occupied Central Causeway Bay and Mong Kok. It's the same group of people who were encouraging all these activities. So I would like to ask, well, they were asking that this council should be investigating into this incident. Shouldn't they be declaring their interest in the whole thing? Given the present composition of the LegCo, and if we are to investigate into the matter, would the investigation would be independent, selfless, and impartial? No, of course not. And what's more ridiculous and absurd is that these political parties and these legislators have been working together with other people, both inside and outside the LegCo, to stage the umbrella movement and the revolution, umbrella revolution. The Mong Kok riot arose against this background. So when they have this request, isn't that a ridiculous and outrageous request? That's number one. Number two, well, in their remarks, they never condemned the rioters in the riot. They never criticized them. They never paid any tribute to the frontline police officers who were bravely dealing with the event. And conversely, they were hurling unreasonable accusations against them, and they were smearing them, insulting them. That was not fair to the law enforcement officers. It was a total disrespect for them, and they were being criticized. I think this is most ridiculous and outrageous. President, Mr. Wong Yuk-man, who moved the motion, I would like to quote his remarks. He tried to legalize this riot, justify the riot, and he was actually harming the young people when he said such remarks. He said a tyrannical government, and he said that the policemen were part of this dictatorial government. He said, well, the government was suppressing the revolution in cracking down on the riot, and he was saying that this was violence against the oppressors. He said that young people were very brave fighters, and the police were abusing their power in the use of force. He said, that he would applaud the young people's spirit of or advocacy for self-determination. How could he use wordings like those? He was totally immoral in saying that. He was spreading very harmful ideology among the young people here. His remarks were shameless. Chinese people have the saying, the smart people will talk while the foolish people will take them these remarks to action. The people who most deserve criticism is not the young people, but really the mastermind behind them. We should condemn most the people who incite and encourage people. They are the devils, and they are heaping praises on their own illegal acts. They were trying to gain the support of the radical groups in trying to stand for re-election in the September electoral election, and they were spending up very precious electoral time in having a debate on this. So their ulterior motive was obvious to everyone. President, Mr. Raymond Wong, said that self-determination or self-independence of Hong Kong is a trend in Hong Kong. And this is something considered natural and understandable in Hong Kong. And this shows blatantly their ulterior motive. In 2013, I was the first one to point out that the spirit of independence of Hong Kong was haunting Hong Kong. And now the spirit continue to haunt us. And it has already taken the form of a devil person who is standing right in front of us now. In the last 15 seconds, I would like to take this chance to once again pay my tribute to the police officers who have bravely enforced the law on the second day of the first Lunar New Year today, this year.
Mr. Ho, on behalf of the PAN Democrats, I want to pay my tribute and condolences to the families of the firefighters who passed away. And I want to pay tribute to all the firefighters and healthcare professionals, as well as the backup staff at the Fire Services Department. I'd like to thank them for their contributions. On the first day of Lunar New Year, for the hawker incident in Mong Kok, it triggered the most serious clash between the police and the public in 7 years. We were all heartbroken at such outrage in Hong Kong and the street clash that ensued. However, CY Leung, the chief executive, did not look into the reasons, and on the second day, he labeled the clash as a riot, and he labeled those who took part in the protests as rioters. If the government found the incident so serious, an independent investigation panel should be set up, headed by an independent judge, to see if there were any lapses in judgments that night, as well as to find out the cause of the incident. This way, they can look into the real reasons behind the incident and how the clash would be triggered by the hawker incident. And as such, he would seek to improve Hong Kong's political climate in order to alleviate such incidents. Now, who was the trigger point? The Labour Party issued a statement. In the statement, we pointed out that CY Leung, the chief executive, has been going backwards in his governance, which led to a lot of complaints from the government, from the public. We also pointed out that the Labour Party embraces peaceful resistance because violence would only fuel further violence, and the public should have the right to know. Under any circumstances, no one can attack media workers. We feel that we must tackle the root of the problem at Hong Kong. A lot of people criticize the Labour Party for not using the word condemn. And the reason is we believe that complaints would not be solved by power. The only way out is to tackle the root and tackle the issue of governance. For the segregation policy in South Africa, a lot of lives were lost, but by the time Nelson Mandela assumed authority, he did not prosecute government officials who stigmatized and killed the black South Africans. He only established a Committee of Peace, requesting explanations by the people who imposed violence on the victims. It was not even a prosecution process, and there were no punishments. The South Africans resorted to peace to eliminate the hatred. But when you look at the Hong Kong government, they purchase water cannons and other equipment. So aside from equipping our enforcement officers with the right tools, we have to look at the root of the issue. And this is not something the enforcement units can tackle. The government should embrace a more humanitarian approach. And we propose appointing a select committee, even though our efforts might be in vain. It would likely not be passed, and even if it's passed, we might not have the time. But we would still do our best because we feel that the media is powerful. The secretary is here today, but what we say to the pro-establishment camp would be in vain. Nonetheless, we still have to explain to the public the power of peace. One day we are going to solve this dilemma. In the past 2 days, the pro-establishment camp has been saying that the acts that challenge the rules of procedure would set a bad example for our young people, and that would lead to that would encourage more violence. And the fact is, people can determine the right from the wrong. The PAN Democrats are a minority at the council. If we can, if what we say can indeed influence people, then the pro-establishment camp should speak more in order to influence the society. If you do not make good use of this platform, then it's your fault. The public can determine the right from the wrong. They would not believe everything you say. They can judge for themselves. Both the PAN Democrats and the pro-establishment camp have a lot to say. So what's the difference? You have to speak with reason. So as long as the public can make a judgment, they would know who to side with. But I urge the government, I urge the public to exercise reason and not have your judgment masked by anger. Whether for the public or the police, any sort of violence would only encourage further violence. So what is the biggest form of violence? It's institutional violence headed by the government and fueled by the pro-establishment camp. When you look at the huge white elephant projects, or things that erode one country, two systems. When, if you want to withdraw money, you have to provide a password, but here you don't even need a password. And we have no idea whether universal retirement protection will be implemented, and projects that are not popular with the public are being passed. So, of course, the people are angry. The police force was sacrificed. They were made the scapegoat. One issue we have to look at is whether the operations that night on the second day of Lunar New Year were excessive. And some frontline police officers were made to face the immediate danger. Those were things we have to look at. As for the prosecutions made afterwards, it should be another scope of investigation. You can see that the judiciary has revoked some of the prosecutions, has withdrawn some of the prosecutions, and some members of the public have been released, and litigation costs were also recovered. Now, if these people did not have legal representatives, they might be misjudged. So one element of the rule of law is that regardless of the offense committed or suspected, that relevant person should undergo a fair judicial process, and they should enjoy legal rights. However, the pro-establishment camp has been ignoring this element under the rule of law. President, the Labour Party is against violence. We are against using violence against violence. The police has been using violence, and the protesters were angered, and they hurt innocent residents and media workers. Violence would only encourage further violence, and we still believe in the power of peace and its influence. And we believe in the power of the public in making changes. Some people no longer believe in protests, and that has affected the element of civil participation. So in the resumption of the second reading of the copyright bill, we only saw 200 to 300 protesters maximum. So it was far less than the protests against national education. So the civil groups involved were all alone. We have seen clashes from time to time, then they would not help advance our society. Now, as responsible organizers, they should consider the safety of participants, and the protest organizers should explain their possible legal liabilities so the participants can make a choice for themselves in whether to participate in the civil disobedience activities. So this way, leaders like Mr. Lee Chuck-yan would be able to encourage more participants. And they should make sure the activities are run properly. And they should look after participants who might have little experience. Now, the constitutional or institutional violence is the root of the issue. Whether you embrace one country, two systems, valiance, Hong Kong independence, or whatnot, I urge the public of Hong Kong to believe in the power of peace. You should not be masked by anger. You should not allow anger to change yourselves, and you should not resort to violence. Thank you.
Mr. Kenneth Leung, Mr. President, I'm speaking on the motion moved by Mr. Wong Yuk-man under the LCPNP ordinance for the setting up of a select committee to inquire into the clashes between the police and members of the public in Mong Kok. In English, there is this idiomatic expression, and it says, Some people may misunderstand what this idiomatic expression means. It means if a person badmouths another person, or if he says nasty things to another person, other people may not know exactly whether that statement or that something is true. that statement is made, maybe for a good cause. And then President Mao Zedong also said, the ice is cold, but it has not been formed only overnight. He also said there is a reason to every love and every hate event. These three statements tell us that there is a cause to everything. And the first expression particularly can describe the views of the public towards CY Leung, our CE. Talking about smoke and fire, Mr. President, allow me to digress a little, because these words bring to mind the fourth alarm fire taking place in Kowloon Bay in recent days. On behalf of the professional commons and members of this council, we'd like to give our highest respect to the two fire officers who died on duty. We would also say this to firemen, policemen, and other ambulance men at the scene of the fire to be able to go back home safely, and I hope the fire will be extinguished soon. Talking about these three expressions, they go to show that there is a cause to everything. Nothing happens without a cause. I talked about the fourth alarm fire in Kowloon Bay. How does that relate to the clashes between the police and members of the public in Mong Kok? What are the common features? There are four, as I see it. Members of the public are concerned about both incidents. Are very unpleasant. And number three, both incidents hurt and harm the lives of members of the public and public officers. And number four, both can be an accident or it could have been deliberate. But of course, about this blaze, there are media reports now, but I won't speculate further, because we still lack information. Yesterday, I heard on the media, now, of course, I hope that after the blaze is extinguished, the relevant departments will investigate into the orders given to extinguish the fire and also the equipment for the fire department. I hope that will be subject to a detailed review. I have heard from a fire officer say that after this blaze, buildings which are over 50 years old without a sprinkler system, there would be a complete survey of such buildings. And it's possible that the legislation will be amended to also regulate industrial buildings and mini storages. By the same token, in this violent clash in Mong Kok, we need to go to the root of the issue. Of course, there are near-term causes and long-term causes, but we cannot just say blindly that there is a minority of people who are stirring up trouble. We will just arrest them, imprison them, sentence them, and then the entire issue will have been dealt with. I still remember, after the conclusion of the Occupy movement, Mr. CY Leung said to this council and the media that there must be foreign forces behind it. Is that the case? There are about 2 years now from the Occupy movement. Has Mr. CY Leung really come to the conclusion that a particular foreign force was behind the Occupy movement? There may not be a single cause only to any incident. The causes may be complicated. And exactly because of this, we have to go into the crux of the matter and tackle it. Certainly. I agree to having a completely independent commission of inquiry headed by a chief judge gathering evidence from experts who may be sociologists, youth workers, and even economists and security experts. But the administration said that won't be done. The next proper way to do it, well, as Ms. Sitho said, that again, this might be just a routine debate because the motion will definitely not be carried. And the council has only 3 weeks to go, and there is no way we can set up a select committee in that short while. However, theoretically, I must support this motion by Mr. Wong Yuk-man because the administration has already said that it won't set up a COI. It says the police has already set up an investigation committee to look into the clashes. But, Mr. President, what does the police investigation include? Is it just about enforcement and the police's deployment and also intelligence collection and equipment for the police? And can that help go to the deep-seated roots of this incident? Mr. President, talking about deep-seated causes, well, there can just be a few types of these. Of course, there are near-term causes and long-term causes, and the triggering point may very well be hawkers hawking and running into conflict with others. But that cannot be the long-term cause or the deep-seated cause of the violent clash. There is grievance. If it cannot be properly vented or relieved, these clashes are bound to happen from time to time. Many people say that these are conflicts. Mr. Chairman, you have been on this travel with rifle program. Now, who are the rivals in this incident? It's not for me to detail all these conflicts, but again, conflicts can only be in a few categories. Some people say it's a class struggle between the rich and the poor. Some people say it's an intergenerational conflict, that the present middle-aged people do not find the young generation agreeable. And number three, it may be an ideological conflict. And what does this mean? In recent times, we have talked about the conflicts between the mainland and Hong Kong. We have different cultures. We have different approaches, core values, including freedom, clean government, etc. We have different views on these values. And it can be internal conflicts within the people. Is it that certain conflicts were ignited suddenly by some people, so we had those clashes? All these, President, are just my own speculation, and I don't know which has caused the conflicts or clashes in Mong Kok. So, as I said, the most proper way to do it is for the administration to appoint a totally independent commission of inquiry. But the second best choice is, and it seems to be the only choice, of course, it is also an impossible choice, and that is to set up a select committee at LegCo according to the LCPMP ordinance. Thank you. I support the motion.
Dr. N. Chang. President. Yesterday, all Hong Kong people received the news that another fireman died on duty. I believe many of us would be like us, are heartbroken, sad. And DAB would like to pay tribute to the brave firefighters who died on duty. We would pray for those firemen who were injured, for the frontline heroes. We would like to render them our greatest support. And I would appeal to legislators that we should not be focusing on our political, different political affiliations and support concertedly the firemen's work. Now, the Mong Kok riot happened on the first day of the Lunar New Year. Mr. Raymond Wong moved a motion. I think it's a premeditated and organized political act. I am against Mr. Raymond Wong's motion. First, why did I say this is a premeditated act? The localist groups who started the action said that they were just trying to buy some fish balls at Mong Kok, but Hong Kong people well know that this was a lie. Well, let's look at how things happened back then. In the afternoon of that day, different localist groups and other people have, through the social media and online media, appealed to the public to go to Mong Kok at 9 p.m. to defend the night market in Mong Kok. And some people even posted such notices during daytime on the online, saying that this is, we should bravely defend the night market in Mong Kok. Well, at 9 p.m., outside Langham Place, Portland Street, 9 p.m., well, so they had an appointment at 9 p.m. And some people even said that they are going to deal with them tonight. So at 9 p.m. that day, a dozen or so people, the people from the localists and natives groups, they were wearing some black face mask, and they were thereby the side of the unlicensed talkers, and they were selling things on the streets. At around 10 or so, the FUHD staff were enforcing the law on site. They tried to advise these unlicensed talkers to leave. These law enforcement officers were criticized or scolded by the Hong Kong indigenous people. They were even using foul language against these law enforcers. And later, some wooden carts with oil, burning oil, these were used to attack the FUHD staff. Well, without any other support, these staff were calling up the police for assistance. So that's why the police got involved. So we can see that during daytime, we already knew that we should have a go at the law enforcers. So why do we not consider as a premeditated event? This is supposed to be a festive season. Everyone should celebrate the Lunar New Year. And they are doing things like that. Miss Claudia Mo, well, asked why do you call this a premeditated event if with the circumstances that I mentioned, she is still calling this a non-premeditated event. If this is so, if we are to, say, buy some fishbowl at the streets late in the future, should we be gearing up ourselves for any possible events? And we clearly see that in that evening, around midnight, shortly before 1 a.m., some people were trying to grab some tools from a lorry or a van at the internal street. There were protective gears and self-made armors. President, it takes time to produce these kind of tools, and they could not be sort of assembled or made easily. So obviously, this is very much a political action, conspiracy to overturn the government. Yesterday, Dr. Priscilla Leung said something very good. She said, in the society these days, a lot of people got angry about this riot. And for people who tried to defend the rioters, well, we resented these people. A lot of people hated you. Well, I share her feelings. A lot of people want to have a stable and happy life in Hong Kong, and they don't want to see you turning Hong Kong into a mess. Yesterday, I heard somebody say the word, the situation is not that chaotic. It's not like the chaos in the 1967 riot. I believe that all of us are clear that the cause for the 1967 riot is that the workers were exploited. And for the riot in early this year, the cause was very much due to some fish balls. And what is the result? At that time, I was very young. I didn't follow what's happening, but I heard some elder people told me after 1967 incident, the government, changed drastically the labor legislation, enhanced labor protection, and even improved district administration work. My father told me, before the 1967 riot, he had to work 7 days a week. However, after that, in 1968, the Home Affairs Department was set up. In terms of education, healthcare, anti-corruption housing, there were major reforms launched. And in 1969, the Hong Kong Festival was organized. And there were many more recreation and leisure activities for Hong Kong people organized. But after the Mong Kok riot, what happened? After the Mong Kok riot, the shops in Mong Kok were suffering. they had poor business. They were adversely affected. And because of this incident, well, the name Mong Kok got famous in the international community. So what happened in Mong Kok, actually? Well, I don't think what DAB's stance matters and how the government considered to be the nature of the event. What matters is most was Hong Kong people's attitude. In a CU Hong Kong survey, 70% of the respondents said that, well, the people should strive for the demand in a peaceful manner. And 64% of the people disagree to radical actions to press the government with their demands. I hope that the opposition members should be clear-minded, try to understand what the majority of Hong Kong people's views are towards the Mong Kok riot. If you do things with political motives, I believe that no matter how many working groups we set up, how many subcommittees we set up, will be of no use because they will just be talk shops. And you were trying to justify the actions of the offenders, you try to gain political mileage for yourself, and you are harming the young people as a result. Try not to be led by the radical groups and lose your own conscience. And ultimately, as what Mr. Ronnie Tong said, some people dare not speak from their conscience and try to lead people into a right path. Conversely, they are just following the public opinion. And you are not really striving or working hard for democracy. You just want to stay or hold on to your own positions. I'm sure you know that Mr. Jimmy Lai, the one respected so much by yourself, recently he wrote an article in his magazine, said that he is going to retire. Why? He said this. He said he's finally awoke because he thinks he's overestimated his own ability, and that is a disaster. So I hope that those who are here today, that your arrogant opposition party members should stay humble and put Hong Kong people's interest first in whatever you do and work for the future of Hong Kong. Don't try to escalate the social conflicts and social divisions in Hong Kong. So I speak.
Mr. Chair again. President, I speak against the motion proposed by Mr. Raymond Wong. And apparently they have two motives. One, they want to criticize the police's handling of the Mong Kok riot. And second, they pointed to an issue with the governance of the administration in the incident. I still do not understand to this day why the Pan Democrats is still looking for excuses for the rioters in Mong Kok. And they are blaming the issue on the administration's governance. As Ms. Carrie Lam, the CS, said, the governance has room for improvement, but this is not an excuse. In the Mong Kok riot, the Pan Democrats accused the police officers for firing their pistols in an improper manner. I think anyone who has watched TV would understand that firing empty rounds would be a natural reaction under the circumstances. I think the PAN Democrats have not reached out to the public for a very long time. You can ask the residents and the teachers how many of them would agree that it's right for rioters to beat up police officers. If the PAN Democrats are willing to ask the residents, I think this is the answer they will get, and that is, it's wrong for rioters to beat up the police. And the conscientious police officers have been demonized and stigmatized, and they are fanning hatred towards police. And that is the real reason why our society is being divided up. The PAN Democrats also point to an issue with governance. Now, President, we have a lot of meetings at the council every day, and we talk about governance all the time. All our policies are related to governance. If the Mong Kok incident is an issue about governance, then we would be setting up select committees all day long to study all kinds of issues. We have members filibustering all the time. Are we going to set up a select committee to find out why they are filibustering? During Occupy Central, the pro-establishment camp proposed setting up a select committee to look into the Occupy movement, and the PAN Democrats were against it. But now they want to set up a select committee to investigate the Mong Kok riot. If a select committee is indeed appointed, then I feel that a select committee should also be set up to investigate Occupy Central. This would only be fair. So I don't understand the logic of the PAN Democrats. They said the pro-establishment camp has no conscience, whereas it's the other way around. I do not see the logic. Since the debate doesn't make sense, I do not intend to speak more. Filibustering has become a norm at LegCo, but I'm grateful that our law enforcement units are still doing their jobs for Hong Kong. I want to take this chance to thank the firemen for protecting us with their lives, and I want to pay tribute to the firefighting heroes. Hong Kong embraces rule of law. We can embrace all kinds of comments, whether they are reasonable or not. But we do not tolerate blatant violence. I acknowledge that the government is not perfect, but this is not an excuse for street violence. So I think what the PAN Democrats said today have been very misleading and also dangerous. The PAN Democrats should not side with the rioters just because they don't like the government. Thank you.
Mr. Wong Ting-kwong. Thank you, President. Before I address the motion, I'd like to pay my respects to fire officers, especially the two who died on duty. I'd like to send condolences to their families. Just now, some members said that the SARG would only buy water cannons. But in the budget this year, PAN Democrats tried to move amendments to slash expenditures for the Fire Services Department. Now look at this. Look at this fire in Kuntang. We need to review the equipment for firemen, whether it should be improved. What are they after? I hope the public will take a look at that. Let me come back to the topic under discussion. Mr. Wong Yuk-man moves a motion to set up a select committee to inquire into the clashes in Mong Kok at Chinese New Year. We saw on television what happened, and it was said that FEHD officers were driving away hawkers, and that led to the disturbances in Mong Kok. I'd like to ask you this. In the entire process, what we saw on TV or other media reports, did you see FEHD officers arresting or driving away hawkers? The FEHD officers were there just to maintain order. We all know that at Langgong Place is a very busy area. There are many people, many cars. Plus, there were hawkers on that night, some selling cooked food, some were using oil and open fire, etc. If there should be an accident and there is injury caused, then again it would be the responsibility of the administration. From messages on the internet and other feeds, we could see that at that night, the Mong Kok clash was premeditated, it was pre-planned. It was also very carefully timed. People gathered in no time. There was also ample preparation for the equipment, including loud hailers, vendetta masks, etc. Just take a look. The crowd was prepared and was ready to act. You said no one was in command. What we saw on TV was there was this Mr. Wong using a loud hailer on the top of a vehicle. He acted like the commander on site, telling people to charge. You don't call that command, then what is? Mr. President, I respect democracy. But democracy is not anarchy. What do we want democracy for? Democracy is only a tool. The goal is harmony and unity. I do feel that what you call democracy is that I am the people, you are the sovereign. You don't want unity, you don't want harmony. I also believe in freedom. Freedom is not non-governance. There is no absolute freedom. You want freedom, but have you considered the freedom of others? Yesterday, Mr. Wong Yuk-man gave an impassioned speech yesterday. And that brought to mind the Nazi speeches that whipped up emotions. Mr. Wong Yuk-man spoke so in this chamber. He did so the same way in primary schools. He also told primary students his speeches, arguments, which stand truth on its head. Some members already commented how Mr. Wong Hyuk-man stood truth on his head. He is anti-China, anti-communist. I respect his stance, but let's have sympathy for their parents. He is leading the children astray. He is pushing them onto the road of criminality, and the children's lives are destroyed. Please stop your act, Mr. Wong. Mr. Wong Yuk-man incites people to cause trouble, and then he always hides behind the crowd. He says the most important thing is to have safety in numbers. If you have the numbers, the law enforcers can't do anything with you. Even in this chamber, he also asks PAN Democrats to crowd around the chairman's table. Just now, some members said the smart will use verbal commands. Only the stupid will act according to those commands. A minority of members are causing chaos here. They want to be valiant, but at the same time, they wear vendetta masks. Are they really valiant? They storm LegCo, they occupied Central, and there is this Mong Kok clash, and then also at university council meetings. All those protesters wore masks, face masks. They wanted to hide their own identity because they were inciting others to cause trouble, and they themselves are stirring up trouble. They are only a minority. This is happening in the U.S. The U.S. is staging an anti-China campaign, and these people belong to that camp. They have no regard for the rule of law. And as I am on this, I must say that they also cause damage to the Hong Kong's economy. Just look at the Occupy movement. Look at the harm done to the Central and Western districts. And also, the harm done to Mong Kok shopkeepers by the Mong Kok clashes. The harm is still felt even today. And what about the harm done to the tourism industry? It's even worse. You think you're only affecting people under the IVS? Indeed, tourists from other parts of the world are shunning Hong Kong. Go on, causing trouble. I don't know whether you have financial support by somebody so you don't have to work for a living. But what about the average worker? If the economy is not good, how can they feed themselves? Please stop your act. Please do not go on causing trouble. Take another look at the Mong Kok clashes. Look at the pan-democrats. Some of them are more rational. They have a stand. They have higher hopes. And they have drawn a line between themselves and some others. And strangely, Mr. Wong has moved the motion, and yet they are coming out together to support it. Well, you really have to register your stance. You should not change your tack. You should stick to your stance because the people are watching. Mr. Wong's speech yesterday was filled with so-called localism, but I believe they were words talking about independence for Hong Kong. Pan-democrats in the chamber, dare you agree with him? Therefore, I hope we will all object to the motion moved by Mr. Wong Yuk-man. Thank you, President.
Yip Kin-yuen.
Mr. Yip Kin-yuen. President, first of all, I would like to pay my tribute to the two firemen who died on duty and for those frontline firemen who are working hard now to put out the fire, and also all the journalists on site. I would like to send them my regards. This is a very serious fire, and I believe all of us here are very concerned, and we feel strongly about it. Today, teachers sent me some short messages, and in the schools, they are holding some memorial services. And I also suggest here that the teachers and principals may like to make use of the weekend to do some preparation for holding some form of memorial service on Monday, be it asking the students to write down their messages and also observe a silent mourning and try to convey the message that we should cherish life and cherish people around us. In this fire, a lot of people in Hong Kong have a lot of queries and doubts. I think we all share the same mourning feeling. But then towards the cause of that fire and how that fire was handled and why the situation has developed to its present situation, and also regulation on many stores, storage rooms, old industrial buildings. We have questions on all these fronts. We are thinking about them. I think this is something very natural. Whenever a major incident happened, well, this is of course a major incident, we often have a lot of questions. And we want to do several things now. We'll try to ascertain the facts, find the cause, and thirdly, and come up with measures, response measures. These are the three things that we want to do. So when the FSD says that it will set up a working group to investigate into these aspects. You think this is very natural? We should not just mourn about things, but we should face up to the question. We should try to explore into the issues concerned and try to resolve them. If the FSD doesn't set up this investigation group, I believe the senior management of the government, including the secretary here, will ask the department to do the same thing, or for the government to set up the investigation team to do the work. If the senior management of the government doesn't want to do that, the LegCo is obliged to do that as well. We must ask the government to set up an investigation committee. If the government is not willing to do it, then it should be the LegCo which should do the investigation itself. Well, there will be people in the community discussing the issue from various angles, whether it's the government's internal investigation, LegCo investigation, discussions in the community. There is one thing that we all want to achieve. We want to face up to the problem, try to ascertain the facts, the causes, and try to come up with proposed measures for improvement. President, the fire that we are facing today, it's similar in nature to the Mong Kok riot. For the Mong Kok riot, do you think this is a major incident? I believe that you will all agree on that. Is this something quite unexpected? Well, the fire has developed to the stage it is now. Well, this is, of course, something unexpected. The same goes for the Mong Kok riot, something unexpected. And it's because it's a major incident, unexpected, so we need to investigate into it. Is this something of concern to us, or how come that a clash with the hawkers will turn into serious clashes between the police and the public? And there were physical scuffles, hurling of bricks, and various violent actions. And it makes us think, why the familiar Hong Kong that we are in will see things like that happening? Isn't this a good cause for us to conduct an in-depth investigation? The best way to do an in-depth investigation is for the government to appoint a commission of inquiry to do the investigation. The commission of inquiry, according to our law, will enjoy, say, the powers of a court. It can call witnesses. It will be headed by a judge. Then this committee can do the work on Hong Kong people's behalf. I think this is the best solution to the problem. So in the past few months at the LegCo, we have urged the government to take up that role. Shouldn't the chief executive take the initiative to do this? Regrettably, after the incident happened, the CE refused soon to do that. He said that he would not set up an investigation or a commission of inquiry. And as a result, we won't be able to look carefully into what happened. And that's why in this debate, we have different views. We express our different views. We use our imagination and we try to make our own interpretation of the event. Well, when you make your remarks, do you have sufficient evidence to back up your remarks? Some people said that this is a premeditated event with somebody in command. It seems so, but is it really the case? We have to get to the bottom of it. Some other people from the other camps said that this is very much a self-initiated action. Is that so? Should we not investigate into it? If people have different opinions and we refuse to investigate, and we said that this is a very serious incident, have wide implications on Hong Kong, is this
responsible approach? Why don't we face up to the problem and try to ascertain the truth? This is the first step that we should take. There are so many question marks related to this Mong Kok riot. We want to know about, we want to have answers to these questions. How come that a minor hawker management issue will evolve into serious clashes between the police and the public? Is it a premeditated event with someone in command, or is this just a self-initiated action? And some people said that the police have read the wrong deployment. Is it a wrong deployment? Who started it, or is it the police, or is it the crowd together there who started off the clashes? What are the reasons why the conflicts have been escalated? Is this the same group who were there at the outset, or some, well, other groups have joined in afterwards? Now, apart from ascertaining the facts, we would have to go into the core of the problem. What are the social conditions behind all these serious conflicts? Is it a long-standing distrust, a result of long-standing distrust of the police? Or is it because of some ideology, social ideology, independence for Hong Kong, localism, or what? What are the young people who turned most radical? Who have done the right thing or the wrong thing, which has sparked some strong response from others now in the whole process? What's the role played by the internet and online platforms? So if the government can set up a commission of inquiry, then it will be able to try to get to the bottom of the matter and try to fix the problem for us. Some members also mentioned just now that because we faced up to issues in the past, so we can come up with new thinking to resolve social conflicts, for example, after the 1967 riot. And also for the Lama incident, we did investigation as well. So as a result, government departments could do a better job, and the society could better identify the problems, come up with solutions. So that's how a society progresses. If we don't face up to the problems, we won't progress. President, I was once embroiled in some incidents myself. In 2007, the Hong Kong IAD had a problem, and at that time, there was discussion in the LegCo on whether the LegCo should conduct an investigation into the matter. Later, the government did things fast, and Donald Zhang, the then CE, undertook to set up a commission of inquiry headed by a judge to do the investigation. As a result, the LegCo didn't pursue the investigation itself. This is a very important incident, and I believe that if LegCo didn't discuss it, I wasn't prepared to do this, and the government didn't set up the commission of inquiry, well, we won't be able to take lessons or learn a lesson from this incident. And justice cannot prevail. And because of this personal experience, I hold the view that whether it be the government, the LegCo, we should be appropriately using our investigative power to get to the bottom of the matter and to propose some recommendations. And this is the way that we can keep a sound system in the society. If we don't use that opportunity, well, are we doing justice to Hong Kong people? We can imagine if we don't face up to the incident, we don't try to find the cause of the
problem and try to come up with better solutions. The similar incidents can recur, and the situation can even get worse. And if situation gets worse, incidents recur, who should be held responsible? Those who don't want to face up to the problem should be held accountable, because in the system, you have the power and the responsibility to do the investigation. If we don't live up to our responsibility, we should be held accountable. We should be queried. So I urge all those in the council, whether it's the pan-democrats and the pro-establishment members, I don't think we need to have a presumption on the nature of the incident. We know that this is a major incident. We have a lot of queries, so we should look into those queries. We should investigate into it, and we should try to come up with solutions. Only by that can we be accountable to Hong Kong people. And the next generation. President, so I speak in support of the motion.
Mr. Lee, President, the DAB would like to pay tribute to the two firefighters who passed away, and we express deep grievance towards the passing away of the firefighters. And we also pay the highest tribute to firefighters who are still at the site. You have the public's support. Some firefighters are still injured, and the hearts of the public are with them, as well as all other firefighters. Hopefully, they can do their best to tackle the blaze. I speak against the motion moved by Mr. Raymond Wong to appoint a select committee on the clashes between the police and members of the public in Mong Kok. So apparently the purpose of this motion is to express political motives. No matter how many people we call upon in the committee, and regardless of the length spent in the committee, the conclusion is already written. Members have spoken in the aftermath of the clashes. As for the cause and conclusion of the Mong Kok riot, members have published them in various means, and I think the investigation results would be expected. One camp would blame the rioters and that the police must be stringent with the violators, and another camp would say that the cause of the riot is a failure in governance. And some people might make use of this report to ask CY Leung to step down. And the police could be accused of abusing power, and that would spell more difficulties in their future operations. So members have already said a lot. So for the public, there's nothing new. Both camps have been adamant. I don't think they can convince one another within a short time. So we are reaching the end of the legislative term. I don't see a need to set up or appoint a select committee to look into the Mong Kok clashes. This committee would only become a political tool. It's a waste of time and money. I don't see any real use in it. So the DAB does not support the appointment of a select committee in the Mong Kok clashes. Given the circumstances, the Legislative Council is not an appropriate platform for launching investigations because LegCo has lost credibility as a neutral investigation arm. Come election time, a lot of members would use LegCo to express their political views, and results of the investigation would only become a political tool. I do not see how the real causes can be identified. To be honest, if we have any further comments being thrown around, it would further affect social harmony. I think the members' stances are very clear. Mr. Albert Chan said that the clashes on the first day of Lunar New Year was instigated by CY Leung, the chief executive. It was a surprising statement. Other members talked about institutional violence, which forced the public to resist with violence. I think the institution is always a process instead of it's not about fairness or integrity. Some members said the government should not, the government should face up to the issue. I agree that the government should reflect upon the incident, and they should be driven to look into deeper issues in our society. But I think those conflicts should be set aside if we want to look into this incident. At LegCo in recent years, there have been a culture of violence, and we have seen a lot of such political statements being thrown around. At the Establishment Committee, Finance Committee, Budget, members have been using various issues to voice their political stance. We don't have the time or need to set up another select committee at LegCo to allow members to further express their political views. President, another reason for standing against Mr. Wong's motion is that we are reaching the end of the legislative term. We would not have enough time to investigate such a complicated incident. So why do we have to wait till now to discuss this issue? The reason is members have been filibustering. Now our the meeting times for the council have been ever changing, and we can only try to pass motions that are crucial to public welfare. So we have held many extra meetings from morning till night, and sometimes on Saturdays and Sundays. Of course, it's our job to attend meetings. But by filibustering and exploiting the rules of procedure, moving motions to adjourn, etc., these mean that we our meetings have clashed, and members often have to attend multiple meetings at the same time. Now, this is not satisfactory at all. If members want to appoint a select committee due to political motives, I would not endorse it. This would further erode our council. In the aftermath of the Mong Kok incident, we have expressed our views on different platforms, so I won't repeat them in detail. I just want to highlight our points. First of all, the radical views of the radical antics of the society were not due to the clash in Mong Kok. And after Occupy Central, we have seen a lot of consequences. For example, mobile Occupy movements, the shopping movements, etc. And members have been throwing objects at the council. They have been filibustering. And the only goal is to jeopardize the government's operation. Outside of the council, some radical groups advocate Hong Kong independence. They have brought some knives, and some people claim to have made bombs. Now, we realize the danger caused by such acts, and such acts are like poison. As the poison spreads, our society would suffer, and our young people would also suffer. History told us that using valiance against violence would only lead to a vicious cycle and jeopardize Hong Kong. We support the police's work, and we would like to thank police officers for carrying out their duty and restore social order. This shows the police force's dignity. And some people have ignored the rioters' acts and instead condemned the police's work. And this is certainly unreasonable. People have been accusing the police for using violence while ignoring the acts of the rioters. So these people are demonizing the police. The frontline officers are often being stigmatized, and this would only increase pressure on the enforcement officers, and ultimately the Hong Kong public will suffer. The people who participated in the Mong Kok riots said they wanted justice, democracy, and ideals. So they are just rationalizing their acts of throwing bricks and setting fires. So those acts are against the principles of democracy. So in the name of democracy, they ignored the law. Now, it was a destruction of the rule of law. The judge is the only place which can determine justice, or else if everyone has their own standards, then there would be different interpretations. This is a dangerous trend, and this is an erosion to the rule of law. Some people have cited civil disobedience, and as such, they turn to valiance against violence, and they rationalize a lot of acts. So we might have to begin to debate whether it's necessary to follow the law. They have been rationalizing such acts, and there are more and more violence and clashes in our society. When we look at history, violence would lead to more violence, and valiance is not a solution. The line in our law is becoming more and more blurred, and Hong Kong is being pushed to a dangerous edge. So we have to be wary of that. President, I speak against Mr. Raymond Wong's motion. Thank you.
Mr. Tung Lee Chair. Thank you, President. Before I speak on the motion moved by Mr. Wong Yuk-man, I'd like to take the opportunity to express my highest respects for the two fire officers who lost their lives
while on duty. I'd also like to send my condolences to their families. And I also wish the injured firemen a speedy recovery. There are firemen working on the scene, and there are other people, officers on the scene. I like to say I respect them, and I would like them to be mindful of their own safety. Mr. President, on the 8th of February, on midnight that day, that is also the first day of the Chinese New Year, we saw a Mong Kok riot. Over 4 months have passed since the incident, but I believe many residents can still remember clearly the chaotic situation and the pathetic acts of the rioters on that night. These people had no regard for the rule of law. They attacked the police who were enforcing the law. They stood in the way of fire services and ambulance officers. They had no regard for people's life or danger, and they were involved in violence. I think the public are very angry about this, and most of the people in Hong Kong would like the police to strictly enforce the law and also to do their best to track down the rioters so the court can make fair rulings. So these rioters who have no regard for the law will be given the punishment they deserve, so we can exemplify the spirit of the rule of law in Hong Kong. Mr. President, some members ask the Legislative Council to invoke the LCPNP ordinance to set up a select committee to inquire into the riot. I object to it. I would question members who moved and supported the motion whether they had a political motive behind this. Maybe they wanted to divert people's attention and would like to relieve the rioters of their responsibility. Actually, on the 16th of February at a security panel meeting at LegCo here, a motion was moved to reprimand rioters for threatening public duty. And we also urged the Security Bureau to deploy more staff to tackle riots and also to improve the accoutrement of the police. On the 26th of February, the House Committee vetoed a proposal to set up a select committee by LegCo. Today, I can't see any justification that can convince me to support Mr. Wong's motion. I object to the Legislative Council invoking the PNP ordinance to inquire into this, but it doesn't mean that I'm not concerned about such riots. Therefore, at the beginning of March, I wrote to the Secretary to express my views on the issue. In that letter, I mentioned that we should look into the causes of the clashes, whether there are people directing the riot behind the scenes. And I also said that most of the people in Hong Kong agree that there should be criminal investigation and the court's judgment and sentencing the rioters. We said there should be such professional handling of the riot. However, in recent years, there have been social conflicts, and they are increasing in number. Some members of the public, when they expressed views on certain issues, they have turned to more extreme tactics. There are also radicals who are publicizing that there should be valiance adopted in the face of violence. So they seem to be rationalizing such valiant conflicts, and that has given rise to more confrontations between the police and the public. From the XRL funding approval and then NTNE funding approval, and also moral and national education, illegal Occupy Central, and at universities, again, some extreme ways have been used to express views, and then we have the Mong Kok riot. In fact, many young people have taken part in all these events. Young people now show more concern towards social issues. They should take part in such discussions, but they should be rational, and we should support them. We should encourage them. Unfortunately, some young people choose more extreme means and also violent resistance, and therefore society as a whole has become more radical and chaotic. Many residents find this heartrending, and they also hope that Hong Kong society can become peaceful and calm again, so that there will be fewer arguments, so that people's livelihood and the economy will not be harmed. Mr. President, there is a slip in social harmony when people express views on government policies. They become more forthcoming, and there are more deep-seated conflicts in society. On that basis, I mentioned this in my letter to the Secretary, that I hope the administration will not sit with their arms folded. In fact, they should do a proper job in handling them. Now, one of the ways to do it is for you to consider setting up independent committees to make comprehensive and pragmatic reviews to investigate into the causes of a lack of social harmony, so you can draw up improvement measures so Hong Kong can find a way out of this quandary, and so there will be social harmony again in society. I believe many members of the public also have that wish. Mr. President, if we want to go at the root of the Mong Kok clashes, I believe court trials of the arrested and sentencing of the convicted would be the best and most appropriate way to deal with this. Therefore, I don't think there is any need at all to set up a select committee to inquire into the incident. Moreover, there has been fanatic filibustering at the council, and the council's operation has been very much affected, and the discussion of topics of different policy areas has been held up. Even if this motion is carried, this term of LegCo just cannot get started with it. Therefore, the opposition party is just taking advantage of this opportunity to stage a political show. Mr. President, I would say again, I object to invoking the PMP ordinance to set up a select committee to inquire into the Mong Kok clashes. So I speak. Mr. Martin Liao.
President, first of all, I would like to take this opportunity to express my condolences to the two firemen who died on duty in Kowloon Bay. And I also like to show my respect to the firefighters who were fighting the fire now. Now, starting from March this year, in relation to Rules of Procedure 26, a petition was made by two members to investigate into the incident which happened in Mong Kok in February 2016. Now, there is only just 1 month left for this term. There are so many
There are three bills which have yet to be scrutinized, and they involve different subjects, and they are contentious. Not to mention that there are other pieces of contentious subsidiary legislation and regulations to be discussed. So we must make the best use of the precious time that we have, or else we will be putting the efforts of the various subcommittees down the drain. Let's accord priority to scrutinizing bills. As what the members who made the petition said, that there is a very remote chance that this select committee can be set up or work. So personally, I think that is totally impossible. So rather, I think we should focus our efforts in scrutinizing the bills. And because of this, I oppose Mr. Wong's motion. 4 months or so have passed. And what happened in Mong Kok during the Lunar New Year, the implications and the aftermath are still being felt. And the violence we saw on TV yesterday, well, the memory still remains with us, and we are surprised and stunned. This is the most serious illegal riot in Hong Kong recent years. A number of rioters blatantly attacked police officers and journalists on site. They set fire to and damaged public properties, police vehicles, and they ripped up the bricks on pavements. Those who have a conscience should condemn such violent acts. And this was organized, this riot was organized by the localists and separatists in Hong Kong. It is undermining the rule of law in Hong Kong and also the hitting the Hong Kong economy. The social harmony has also been undermined seriously in Hong Kong. I believe that those who really love Hong Kong will not tolerate such violent acts and will not condone them. The cause of the riot, the process, and the harm it has done to the society now in this age where there is a good flow of information, well, all of us can come to our own conclusion. I won't say anything more. And I think, I hope that the police, after arresting the offenders, could collect evidence ASAP and present and hand over the cases to the court to further deal with them. We rely on our judiciary, and we hope that it can be made clear to everyone that illegal acts would not be condoned, and no one can use any excuse to cover up their acts of damaging or destroying the society or venting their dissatisfaction towards the society. This motion is to appoint a select committee to inquire into the clashes between the police and the members of the public in Mong Kok on the first and second day of the Lunar New Year, and also there were a number of casualties, caused injuries to many people, and other related matters. In simple terms, the causes, the process, and the implications or impact on the society are to be inquired into. Now, as I said, we have an open information system nowadays, and different groups and different media organizations have already uploaded what happened onto the internet. So all we need to do is to key in the four words "wrong rights in Mong Kok" in our computers and smartphones. We can find a lot of pictures and articles and which come with different perspectives. And also on the day of that event, the government said that the FEHD Hawker Management Team was in fact not taking any law enforcement actions against the hawkers. So it was not a case of the government officials oppressing people and they had an uprising. Conversely, the rioters were charging the FEHD staff. Now, given the, considering the safety of the people, the police arrived to maintain order and order and later evolved into the situation where the rioters were charging at the frontline police officers. All these could be seen at the channels or the avenues that I mentioned. You could watch it once or repeatedly. The process has been clear. It's not ambiguous at all. And what is the nature of the Mong Kok riot, President? Well, I think that's obvious. It's a large group of rioters and organized by the localists and separatists. Well, were deliberately disrupting the order of the society, and it was an illegal act. This is a very much a serious, violent criminal act. Should we be acting on behalf of the police to do investigation, collect evidence? So, President, this is exactly why I opposed to this motion. Since the reunification, Hong Kong society has been facing a lot of challenges and difficulties. For example, the financial crisis, economy slowdown, and infectious diseases, wealth gap, shortage of housing, political bickering, and so on. Every term of government has devoted a lot of efforts to tackle these issues. Now, since the current term of government assumed office, has also faced a lot of problems. For example, pregnant women coming to give birth and gate crashing A&D department, supply of formula arts across boundary students, primary one school allocation, parallel traders, multiple entry visa for Shenzhen residents, etc. We should not belittle the efforts made by the government to tackle the problems. Of course, everyone has his own opinion on the effects of these measures, but there is this group of people who blindly makes criticisms and yet without coming up with any constructive proposals and recommendations or taking concrete actions to help resolve their problem. Conversely, they know how to filibuster in the LegCo, and they are dragging our feet, delaying our progress. Even if the government has devoted a lot of efforts to try to remedy the problems, I think that efforts only yield half the results because of these group people's acts. Now, a lot of people say that young people's dissatisfaction with the society is a cause for the social division. And some young people are affected by the localists and separatists, and they participate in a number of anti-government protests and clashes with the government. Now, recently, property prices are on the high side, and the industries are not diversified enough, and young people have a low possibility of social mobility. That's very different from our generation. We have a lot of experience, our generation, but then young people are living in a relatively more comfortable environment. Our experience cannot directly apply to their situation, and we might not be able to understand their thinking and needs. And communication is a two-way process. If we just unilaterally preach our principles, and we are not working together with the young people and facing their problems together with them, then that's not a help to the young people. The government should be humble and should have a direct dialogue with the young people and should not just be communicating with the so-called young people's leaders, and it should not be arrogant and refuses to listen to young people's views, or else the relationship between two can only get worse. President, the law enforcement bodies have started criminal investigation into Mong Kok riot, and some cases have been referred to the DOJ already. As the LegCo, we are representatives of public opinion. Shouldn't we be doing our own job and deal with matters in the LegCo, and should not investigate on behalf of the police? So I speak.
Mr. Stephen Ho.